Penguin Random House Audio presents The AI First Company: How to Compete and Win with Artificial Intelligence by Ash Fontana. Read for you by Lachlan Woods. Note to listeners, this program includes a downloadable PDF that contains diagrams and tables from the book. Introduction. The animal kingdom is full of creatures with better senses than us humans. We can't see like owls or smell like dogs or hear like whales. Nor can we do arithmetic faster than a computer, a creature of our own creation. But we are great at gathering a lot of information across our senses and processing it in parallel to learn fast. This learning fast is the definition of intelligence. Now, artificial intelligence, AI, can help us learn faster by gathering valuable data, processing it into information, and spreading it across networks. Companies that build AI increase their own intelligence. That's what this book is all about. Building AI-first companies with extraordinary capabilities of gathering, processing, and communicating information to where it's needed, when it's needed, to learn faster than the competition. AI-first companies were the first, and are still the only, trillion-dollar companies, and they will dominate more industries more definitively than ever before. This is your guide to building an AI-first company. The new tools. We like to make new tools and, by doing so, power through our natural limits. Charles Babbage, who arguably invented the first mechanical computer, said, "It is not a bad description of a man to describe him as a tool-making animal." We use our intelligence to learn how things work and build tools to make them work better, turning the gradual evolution of man into the fast revolution of man plus machine. The first wave of tools during the Stone Age, at least 2.6 million years ago, brought physical leverage. Think rope traps and spears. These allowed us to go beyond our immediate physical reach to gather more food than we could with our bare hands. The industrial era of the 18th and 19th centuries brought us increasingly complicated sets of tools that worked in harmony to plough fields and mill steel. However, this physical leverage and scale were limited by our intellectual capacity. The second wave brought intellectual leverage. The printing press distributed information, but then computers allowed us to gather more information and perform computations beyond our ordinary intellectual reach. We learned how to move information around, throw it into a calculator, quickly send it to different places, and generate multiple insights. However, this intellectual leverage was limited by how much information we could acquire about the future. Artificial intelligence brings the third wave of tools that give us decision-making leverage. These tools are affording us an entirely new form of intelligence that gathers, processes, and communicates information to make better decisions. We're learning better and faster as we see these decisions play out. Let's thread a needle. In the first wave, it was possible to stitch fabrics faster than we could weave by hand, using looms full of little levers. Physical leverage. In the second wave, computers turned drawings, visual information, into patterns for the loom to automatically weave. Informational leverage. The third wave changes the game. Computers scan photos posted on social media, figure out consumer trends, draw up new styles, and turn drawings into patterns for the loom. New styles hit the stores right as they become fashionable. Temporal leverage. Whereas earlier tools gave us physical and intellectual leverage, AI provides decision-making leverage that fulfills two important imperatives. The first applies to all of society, getting more out of our limited resources. The second applies to businesses, building a competitive advantage. Whereas land, labour, and capital were the resources leveraged to compete in the last millennium, information is now the resource to leverage. Whereas the leading companies of yesterday excelled at managing land, labour and capital, tomorrow's leaders will excel at managing information. There are many books about using land, labour and capital to win at business. This book is about using information to win. The AI First Century. The AI First Century started in 1950 with the development of AI and will finish around 2050 with AI being fully deployed across all industries. So it's not too late for you to get started on applying AI in your industry. The first half of the AI First Century, 1950 to 2000. If the first 50 years from 1950 to 2000 were about getting AI to work in the lab, then the next 50 are about getting AI to work for people, business, and society. Understanding how it took the better part of a century to get to this point makes recent innovations seem even more remarkable and highlights our readiness to integrate AI with business strategy. We've thought AI was just around the corner for a long time, but it turns out that it was just getting started. And we are only now bringing working AIs into the real world. Here is the story of the people who built AI, bit by bit, over the last half century. They are the ones who got us here, and you are the one who will take their work forward over the next half century with the help of this book. Theoretical foundations. The foundational thinking about AI happened in the 1950s. Individuals experimented, thought partners collaborated on equations, and groups of great thinkers formed to define artificial intelligence. Mathematician Warren McCulloch and neurologist Walter Pitts wrote the first equations representing what happens in our minds. McCulloch was educated on the streets of Detroit, Pitts at an East Coast private school. Both were founding members of the cybernetics movement, the science of control and communication in machines and living things. Walter was particularly prodigious. Invited to study at England's Cambridge University when he was just 12, after mailing corrections to the great British philosopher and mathematician Bertrand Russell's Principia Mathematica, a three-volume work on the foundations of mathematics. He ran away from home when he was 15 to visit Russell at the University of Chicago, and never saw his family again. Even though Warren was 24 years older than Walter, they spent a lot of time together across societies formed to understand the human mind, and through institutions such as Massachusetts Institute of Technology, MIT. They also drank a lot of whiskey together. Their partnership yielded an important model known as the Threshold Logic Unit, a mathematical model of a human brain cell, or neuron, that explains how the brain computes things. This model of the atomic unit of our own intelligence provided the starting point for creating artificial intelligence. Neuroscientists, computer programmers, and researchers from a wide range of disciplines formed groups to discuss how our brain works and how to represent its functionality, first on paper and then in a computer program. These discussions borrowed concepts from logic, computation, neuroscience, communication, and much more. One group at Dartmouth College coined the term artificial intelligence in 1956. Another at Cornell University created a perceptron algorithm that improved the ability of the earlier algorithms to mimic human neurons. And one at Stanford University joined these neurons together in an early, small version of an artificial neural network. The 50s also brought us the first consideration of how to use AI outside the lab, with the great Alan Turing coming up with a test for intelligence based on reaching a human-level quality of conversation. All the while, Pitts was studying frogs. Among his discoveries, the fact that different parts of a nervous system each carries out a degree of computation. The decade was foundational for AI theory, but the practice was just getting started. Progressing to practice. In the 1960s, research on thinking progressed to sensing and speaking, researchers at MIT, the US Defense Department's Defense Advanced Research Projects Agency, DARPA, and International Business Machines, IBM, studied how neurons move when sensing and reacting to stimuli in the environment. And they wrote computer programs to understand natural language, vision, and reasoning. Around this time...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.